This is a story that starts with the moon and some microbes, and it ends potentially with your existence. This is possibly one of the coolest things I've learned about in a while, but first, let's take a dive. Welcome to the Middle Island Sinkhole. This is a sinkhole about 300 feet wide, about 75 feet underneath Lake Huron, one of North America's famous Great Lakes. You might notice that this place is pretty barren. There aren't really fish or big plants, just fuzzy algae-looking stuff on the rocks. And that's no accident. Most plants and animals don't want to live here, not because it's the bottom of the lake, but because they'd suffocate. See, the Middle Island Sinkhole is sort of a mini habitat. It's actually fed by groundwater, and that groundwater contains virtually no oxygen and a whole lot of sulfur. It's so unpleasant that the only things that care to live here are microbes. But for anyone who's curious about the world, that's great, because despite living in a cold, airless pit, these microbes are helping us understand how the entire planet got its oxygen. So when Earth first formed, it didn't come pre-packaged with the atmosphere we're both breathing right now. For more than a billion years, there was very little oxygen in the air. And without it, all of the complex oxygen-breathing life we see around us, including, you know, us, couldn't evolve. So, like you might expect, scientists have spent a lot of time trying to figure out exactly how oxygen got into the atmosphere. Overall, the consensus is that it had to do with tiny organisms called cyanobacteria. More than 2 billion years ago, the ancestors of these microbes were the first life on Earth to start using oxygenic photosynthesis. That's the kind of photosynthesis you might be familiar with. It's the same thing that, like, your houseplants do. They take in carbon dioxide, water, and sunlight, make food for themselves, and release oxygen as a byproduct. And when life first started doing this billions of years ago, eventually that oxygen made its way into the atmosphere. But also, that can't be the entire story. Like, there was also a time where Earth's oxygen levels went up and then stayed constant for more than a billion years and then went up again. So, like, what happened there? Well, that's where that sinkhole comes in, because last month, in August 2021, a team of researchers published a paper that might explain things. By studying microbes from that inhospitable Middle Island sinkhole, they found that Earth's oxygen levels may have been directly linked to how long a day was. And if that's a weird sentence, yeah, it kind of is. The truth is, days on Earth were not always about 24 hours long. I mean, one day is just how long it takes for the planet to spin all the way around, right? So if the planet is spinning faster or slower, days will be shorter or longer. And in the case of baby Earth, days were significantly shorter. We can tell partly thanks to math and physics experiments, but also because we can see the evidence in things like coral fossils. Corals grow in daily and annual cycles, and they make growth bands that are kind of like the rings on a tree. So by counting those growth bands, we can see how many daily cycles were in a yearly cycle, or how many days were in a year. Side note, I actually have a coral fossil sitting on my desk and was kind of disappointed to find that I can't really clearly or at least confidently see the growth bands in this thing. So, I don't know, if you happen to have the equipment and want to take a cross-section of my coral fossil and analyze it for me, give me a shout, we can talk. Regardless, what scientists have found in coral fossils that are, you know, clearer than this one is that a yearly cycle used to have more days in it. And since, from what we can tell, Earth's path around the sun hasn't changed, so the amount of time in a year hasn't changed, well, that means each day had to be shorter. More specifically, scientists have found that days used to be about 22 hours long a few hundred million years ago. And if you rewind the clock way back, using math and physics, well, back when Earth first formed, days may have been as short as 6 hours long. So, how did we slow down? You can thank the moon for that one. Exactly how that works is beyond the scope of this video, but the summary version is that the moon's gravity pulls on something called the tidal bulge, which gradually slows the planet. Friction is also involved. If you're curious, here's an animation that more or less sums it up. So, how did these researchers connect the length of a day to Earth's oxygen levels? Well, that brings us back to the Middle Island Sinkhole. Like I mentioned earlier, this place isn't just a pit in the bedrock. It's a mini habitat fed by groundwater that's rich in sulfur and very much lacking in oxygen. But really, that makes it a pretty good analog for what we think Earth's shallow seas used to be like billions of years ago. And that means by studying this sinkhole, we can potentially learn something about the history of our planet. Since the Middle Island Sinkhole in particular is so delightfully inhospitable, the only things that really want to live there are microbes, and here I'll focus on two kinds. The first is called sulfur oxidizing bacteria. They're kind of white, and they partly get their energy from sulfur compounds in the water, specifically one called hydrogen sulfide, which overall just really makes the Middle Island Sinkhole kind of perfect for them. The other kind of microbe is cyanobacteria, which I mentioned earlier. Here, they're kind of a purplish color, and they get their energy from photosynthesis. They use sunlight plus a few other things to make food. Now, if you know a bit about biology, you might be tempted to skip ahead here. Like, when I got to this point, I thought, okay, well, photosynthesis uses sunlight and makes oxygen. So longer days equals more sunlight equals more oxygen? Well, sort of. But there's more to it than that. And this part of the story is actually what got me so hooked I wanted to make this video. So, imagine it's dawn at the Middle Island Sinkhole, early enough that the sun isn't really up yet. At this point, the white sulfur oxidizing bacteria are actually sitting in a layer on top of the purple cyanobacteria. They're hanging out, taking in compounds, including hydrogen sulfide, and turning them into food. Meanwhile, the purple cyanobacteria, well, they don't have any sunlight, so they're really not doing much. But then, as the sun rises, things start to change. Now that they've got some sunlight, those purple cyanobacteria start doing photosynthesis. But it's not the kind you might be thinking of. They start doing what's called anoxygenic photosynthesis. Anoxygenic because it doesn't produce oxygen. Instead, the bacteria are taking in sunlight, hydrogen, carbon dioxide, and hydrogen sulfide, and using that to make energy for themselves. And with the cyanobacteria now competing for that hydrogen sulfide, eventually the white sulfur oxidizing bacteria don't have enough to keep making food for themselves. So as the day goes on, eventually the white bacteria migrate underneath that purple layer, presumably in search of more hydrogen sulfide, but that's actually something that's still being researched. Meanwhile, now that just about all of the hydrogen sulfide is gone, the purple cyanobacteria switch gears. They start performing oxygenic photosynthesis. That's the kind I mentioned earlier that your houseplants do, and it's the kind of photosynthesis that releases oxygen. The cyanobacteria keep doing this kind of photosynthesis until the sun goes down, photosynthesis time is over, and eventually the white bacteria migrate back up to the surface. If you're wondering why the white bacteria come back, that's another still being researched kind of question. It might be because hydrogen sulfide levels are starting to go up again, thanks to other microbes, but it might also be because they actually need oxygen to make energy for themselves. Regardless, you've got this sort of daily shift change going on. But there's a catch. It's not like this process is like flipping a switch. It's not like the hydrogen sulfide runs out and then somebody blows a whistle and the bacteria all switch places. There's actually a delay. In this new paper, the researchers found that after the hydrogen sulfide runs out, it's another 1 to 8 hours before the white bacteria move lower in the sinkhole. And this, we're about to do it. We're about to go full circle. This is where the length of a day really starts to matter. If you have a really short day, say like 12 hours long, the cyanobacteria aren't gonna get a lot of time in bright, direct sunlight. Most daylight hours are gonna be taken up consuming hydrogen sulfide and just waiting for the white bacteria to move. So in the end, they'll make some oxygen, but then the microbes around them will use it up overnight. This is also what the researchers found when they took some of these microbes and brought them into the lab. But if days are longer, cyanobacteria get more sun time. They have more bright sunlight and more time to produce oxygen. So they'll start to make more oxygen than their neighboring microbes can use. And eventually, that excess oxygen will end up in the water and then in the atmosphere. If this idea is right, it means that Earth's days needed to be a certain length before oxygen levels could go up. Specifically, in those lab experiments, the researchers found that you needed at least a 16-hour day to get excess oxygen. But what's also just really cool to me is how this might also explain why Earth's oxygen levels stalled at one point. See, evidence shows Earth's oxygen levels jumping up at two points in history. Once about 2.4 billion years ago, and again 600 million years ago. Between then, everything was pretty stable. So what might have changed? During that time, the length of a day was not changing. The moon's pull on the Earth was likely being balanced by other factors, things like maybe the tides or where land masses were. So maybe something about the length of a day being constant meant that oxygen production was also constant. Maybe they both settled into some kind of equilibrium. Overall, this idea about the relationship between the length of a day and oxygen levels, it's a new one. So we don't have all the answers yet. And there are still some variables the researchers haven't looked into. But it looks like there's some kind of connection. And if there is, it would mean that not only have microbes shaped complex life on Earth and your existence, but so has the physics of the moon. So we may not have time machines, but sometimes looking really closely at the world around us can give us some pretty good leads as to how the Earth we recognize came to exist. This is one of those stories that really made me marvel. So many things about it were new and interesting to me, even though I thought I was familiar with them. So thanks for joining me for this story. I hope you learned something cool, and I hope it's helping you marvel at the world a little bit more too. Side note, I don't promote my art on here very often, but this is the thing I painted. She's kind of shiny. There we go. She's kind of shiny. She's done in acrylics. You can hang her on your wall. And this is available for sale in my Etsy shop. And who knows? Maybe this moon is the reason we're both breathing right now. Thanks again, and I'll see you next time.